In this video, you'll learn how to create off-screen markers that can be used to show the player the locations of objects that are not within the camera's view range. This is useful to inform them of nearby hazards or loot that you wouldn't want them to miss out on. Howdy, and welcome to Game Endeavor. If you want to learn more practical dev skills and improve the quality of your games, then subscribe and ding-a-ling that bell. It is extremely frustrating to be playing a game and suddenly you take damage from an unknown source that you couldn't possibly have foreseen. The more your players are aware of their surroundings, the better they'll be able to react to it. We're going to improve the feedback of your game by providing the player with a little heads up when something is just off camera. We'll be displaying these markers along the edge of the screen so that you can see where they are and react to them. Now I hear you saying to yourself, wait a minute, this sounds similar to a minimap. And yeah, you're not far off. KidsCanCode has a video on creating a minimap which covers UI creation, managing the nodes, and even zooming the minimap in and out. There's an iCard in the corner. For those of you wanting to create off-screen markers, let's go ahead and get started. The marker is going to be its own little scene that we're going to instance onto objects that we want to show. I already have a scene prepared for the marker. The root of the scene is a node 2D with a sprite which we'll use for our marker icon. We're going to be rotating this icon so that it's always on screen, so set the sprite's offset to the pivot point where you want the marker to rotate around. And the sprite will need to be pointing towards the right while having a rotation of 0. We can also place an icon in this marker so that we can provide even more information as to what to expect just off screen. The icon will be rotating so that it is always upright, so make sure that its pivot point is set up properly as well. Inside of the script, I already have these nodes cached into an onReady variables. The first thing we're going to do is move our marker so that it can go no further than the bounds of our camera. We're going to do this inside of a method we'll create named setMarkerPosition. This marker is going to need a parameter named bounds, which will be a rect2. We'll be using this to restrict the marker. When we pass in the bounds rect2, it's going to be set up so that we can use it to determine the top, bottom, left, and right of what the camera is displaying. So all we need to do is clamp our sprite's position within this area. We're going to be moving the sprite's position rather than the marker's position, mainly to give you more control. This will allow you to place the marker more precisely and align everything using the displacement of the positions. We'll say sprite.globalposition.x equals clamp globalposition.x bounds.position.x bounds.in.x, which will clamp the sprite within the left and right sides of the camera. We can duplicate this line of code because we want to do the same thing again but for the Y value, which will clamp the sprite within the top and bottom of the camera. And as simple as that, we have a sprite bound to the camera. However, if the object comes on screen, then the marker is still visible and will follow that object. In this case, we no longer have a need to show the marker, so we want to hide it. There are several ways to detect whether or not it's on screen. Godot provides a node called the Visibility Notifier 2D, which you can use if you want. I find it to be a little too inaccurate for this purpose, though. It can be triggered before it properly enters the screen, leaving a bit of uncertainty as to where it actually is. Recall, however, that we have this lovely little bounds parameter that defines the camera's view for us. We can use this to check if the marker is on screen by simply saying if bound.hasPosition global position. Remember that we're moving the sprite to the edge of the screen, not the marker node itself, which means that the marker scene is exactly where you placed it on the object. If this is true, then it means that the object is on screen, so we no longer need to show the marker. We'll say hide to make it invisible. If you want to continue showing the marker once it has left the screen again, then we can say else show to show the marker once it leaves the screen. We have the marker placed where we want it, but the rotation is staying the same, which isn't very useful if your object is anywhere but to the right of the camera, or even worse, if it's rotating with the object. We want to point the marker's sprite inward from the camera's bounds. Since we're clamping the marker's sprite to the camera's bounds, this is as simple as rotating the sprite away from the marker node itself. We'll create a function for rotating the sprite called setMarkerRotation. We'll get the angle needed for rotating the sprite away from the marker node by saying varAngle equals globalPosition minus sprite.globalPosition.angle. This gets the displacement vector between the two and uses that to get the angle between them. We'll then use this angle by saying sprite.globalRotation equals angle. We're using global rotation here to counteract any rotation that may be placed upon the marker from its family tree, such as if you have rotating asteroids. Once we rotate our marker, however, the icon we placed on the marker is going to rotate as well. We'll cancel this out by setting icon.globalRotation equal to 0. We have our logic implemented, but we haven't called it yet, so it's not doing anything. We're probably moving our parent object in the physics process method, so likewise we're going to update our marker here as well. We're going to need a few things for creating our bounds variable. Mainly, we need to know where our camera is and the size of its view. There isn't a clean-cut way of getting this, but Godot provides us with a bit of information so that we can figure it out ourselves. We're going to need two things for this, the first being the top left corner of the camera. We can get our canvas transform by saying get canvas transform, which we'll store in a variable named canvas. This holds information such as the camera's position and scale. We'll create a variable named top left for storing the top left position of our camera. Canvas origin is the unscaled and inverted top left of our camera. We can uninvert it by tacking on a negative sign in front of it. If you have your camera zoomed in or out, then this doesn't take that into consideration, so we then need to divide it by canvas.getScale. We also need to get the scale of our bounds, so we'll create another variable named size. Our canvas transform only stores the location, scale, and rotation. It doesn't store the dimensions of our camera. But we can get the unscaled size of our camera by saying getViewportRect.size, and then adjust it by the zoom of our camera by dividing it by canvas.getScale. We have the information we need now to create the bounds rect for setting our marker position. We can call our setMarkerPosition method now, passing to it a rect2 with a constructor of top left and size. Then call our setMarkerRotation method. If you run this, then you should have off-screen markers in your game. This works well enough, but due to how we're clamping the marker to the edge of the screen, this starts to become inaccurate when aiming something towards the camera, rather than slowly approaching it. Using a tiny bit of trig, we can fix this. To do this, we need to know what we're aiming at, so we're going to create a class property named targetPosition. You will need to update this manually yourself. You can set this inside of whatever you're attaching the marker scene to. Back in our setMarkerPosition method, we want to add an if condition checking if our targetPosition variable is null. If this is true, then we're not aiming at anything, so we can just apply the clamping logic that we implemented earlier. Otherwise, we have something to look at, so let's see about improving our logic. We're going to need the displacement from our marker to our target, so I'm going to store this inside a variable named displacement, which is going to be global position of our marker minus the target's position. We're mostly going to use this to get the angle from our target to the marker, but we'll also need the distance along the x and y axis individually. Imagine the information we want as a triangle. Point A is our target's position. Point B is clamped to the camera's bounds and shares either an x or y axis with point A. And point C is also clamped to the camera's bounds, but it is between our marker's position and our target position. We need to find point C because that's where we want to place our marker. You'll notice that this is a right triangle, meaning that one of these angles is a perfect 90 degrees. This means that if we have a few pieces of information from this triangle, then we can use a bit of trigonometry to determine the length of the line from point A to point C and place our marker there. So we'll create a variable named length. Well, we know the angle between point A and point C due to our displacement variable. We also know the length of point A to point B, again, due to our displacement variable. Interestingly enough, this is all the information we need. However, we have two axes that we need to consider. Should the marker hit the top or bottom of our camera bounds, then our point B will have the same x-axis as our target, and we will need to use the y-axis for displacement. But if the marker hits the side of our camera bounds, then the marker moves along the y-axis and we will need to use the x-axis for displacement. So we need a way to determine which displacement axis we need. What we're going to do is check the angle of our displacement variable against the angle from our target position and compare it to each corner of our camera's bounds. We can use that information to determine which axis the marker will fall along. To make this easier to read, we're going to store the angle from the target to the camera's corners in a variable for each corner. We're going to be using a vector2 at each of the corners, then subtracting that by the target's position to get a displacement variable, and then taking the angle from that. Once we have our angles, we can check which side our displacement angle is between. It's easier for us to check the top and bottom bounds first, so we'll say if displacement.angle is greater than the top left angle, and displacement.angle is less than the top right angle, meaning that it falls somewhere between the camera's top bounds, or displacement.angle is less than the bottom left angle, and displacement.angle is greater than the bottom right angle, meaning that it falls somewhere between the bottom of the camera's bounds. If either of these is true, then we should be using the y-axis for our displacement variable. Now that we know this, we can get our y-length by clamping the displacement y. And we want to clamp it between the distance of our target position to the camera's top and bottom bounds. So the minimum value is bounds.position.y minus targetPosition.y. The maximum value is bounds.n.y minus targetPosition.y. To calculate the length from A to C, we're going to need the angle of our displacement. But if we were to just get the angle of our displacement variable here, then it would be the angle relative to vector2.right. We need it to be relative to the vertical axis. So we're going to create an angle property and set it to displacement.angle. We'll then subtract pi divided by 2.0 to offset it 90 degrees. With that done, getting the length from A to C is as simple as dividing the length of y by the cosine of our angle. Something we should consider, though, is that if the marker is perfectly aligned with the target position of our x-axis, then the cosine of angle will be 0, and this will create a black hole. However, if this is true, then we know that the y-length is the same as the length from A to C. Therefore, we can just set our length property to y-length using a ternary operator. This handles the top bounds of our camera, but we also need to do the side bounds. Fortunately, it's the same logic, just on a different axis. So we can copy everything in this if condition, create an else condition for the other axis, and paste our logic here. Using Ctrl-R, we can open our replace window and replace every instance of the letter y with the letter x instead. We're going to need to change our angle so that it uses the normal angle instead, which is just displacement.angle. Now we have the length from A to C, we just need to convert this to a position for our marker. Time for a little confession. There are many ways of converting an angle and a length into a vector too. You could use cosine and sine of the angle multiplied by the length to find the x and y value respectively. Or you could do as I've been previously doing, and take vector2.right.rotatedAngle times length. It works, don't judge me. But as it turns out, Godot provides us with a nifty little method that does this for us, which I learned thanks to Lucy from our Discord community. We'll be using it, saying sprite.globalPosition equals polar2Cartesian. This method takes in a length and an angle, and will convert it to a position for our sprite. However, this vector is relative to our target position, so we will need to add it back into the position. With this, we have implemented the improved logic for our marker. Be sure to watch KidsCanCode's video on how to create a minimap, and if you haven't joined our Discord community yet, then come and say howdy. There are many fantastic developers there that are sharing their game development journey, and you are encouraged to do the same. There's a link in the description, and I'll see you there.